After paying his bills, his savings account, and life insurance premiums, there never seems to be enough money left.
It was a very different time 50 years ago. There wasn't financial planning in a comprehensive, sort of well-coordinated sense. Often heavily focused on the investment side, we did not have the types of formality in the process that we now have.
On December 12, 1969, 13 men met in a hotel outside Chicago's O'Hare Airport to discuss a new way of delivering financial advice. Over the course of 2 days, the group would articulate their vision for a new profession, one that would concentrate on helping clients manage their finances.
So the Chicago 13 really did something very unique by converting the industry into a profession. They created a curriculum. There was now education that we'd have to take, more consistency throughout the profession of what are the things we all had to learn so the profession can grow.
We saw that these highly motivated individuals took it upon themselves to push forward a profession in financial planning by essentially establishing the body of knowledge, to establishing a code of conduct, and to have some sort of governing structure that would truly make it a more distinguishable profession.
The meeting's organizer, Lauren Dunton, was a former vacuum and encyclopedia salesman who had reinvented himself as a financial consultant and would become a public figurehead for the new movement towards the profession of financial planning. The meeting gave rise to the International Association for Financial Planning and the College for Financial Planning. By 1973, the college had certified its first class of just 42 planners. They would in turn form the Institute of Certified Financial Planners, a membership organization to support continued networking and career advancement. These first financial planning professionals would begin to practice just as America entered a new period of economic uncertainty. The critical role of the financial planning profession came quickly into focus. A defined financial planning process provided a personalized and repeatable method of helping clients address their finances holistically. New membership organizations formed and grew within and adjacent to the discipline of financial planning, and a growing number of designations supported financial planner education. Even the accounting profession recognized the demand for financial planning with the creation of the Personal Financial Planning section and the CPA-PFS credential. As the discipline took hold, an independent standard-setting body was created to protect the integrity of the CFP certification. The International Board of Standards and Practices for Certified Financial Planners, later renamed CFP Board, would adopt the Code of Ethics and Professional Standards that has set the CFP certification apart from other designations.
The financial planning profession has really moved in the direction of providing holistic advice. That goes hand in hand with the fiduciary standard. Every recommendation that I make has to be in the sole best interest of my client.
The young profession showed signs of strength on multiple fronts. With the growing number of CFP certificates, demand grew for new academic opportunities. In 1987, CFP Board first registered 25 financial planning education programs at institutions around the country. That number grew rapidly to several hundred, with institutions offering bachelor's and graduate degrees, including the first PhD program in financial planning in the year 2000.
Having certified financial planners in a lot of different countries brings a whole new aspect to what we're doing. We can learn from them and they can learn from us. We have a lot of synergy with things that are going on around the world, and that's pretty exciting.
To support growing international interest in the profession, the Financial Planning Standards Board was created in 2004. Together with its affiliate members, FPSB assumed oversight of CFP certification outside of the U.S. And alongside the profession's new strength came a growing consensus surrounding the importance of the fiduciary standard. That principle would face a major test in 2007.
The FPA lawsuit against the SEC regarding these fee in lieu of commission accounts that essentially allowed the brokerage community to charge fees but still avoid the fiduciary responsibility, it was really a pivotal time.
And the court said, if you're providing advice on a fee basis, you need to do that under the Advisor Act and the fiduciary standard that goes with it. And the question was, if not now, when? And if not us, who. It was a long time coming, a lot of people involved, but a very important group decision to stand for what we think is the baseline standard for the financial planning profession.
The financial planning profession developed during a period of remarkable historical change. It has evolved in response to monumental shifts in the economy, in regulatory structures, in investment products and strategies, and in technology. Across the financial services industry, new business models have grown to facilitate the delivery of financial planning to clients within firms both large and small.
The way my father practiced financial planning in the 1970s was obviously very different than the way we do it today. Originally, they were a binder of materials that covered a lot of different areas of a client's financial situation. Now we're a lot more online. We've got more information that's integrated within software systems. The plans that we have now are a lot more agile, a lot more flexible, and a lot more relevant.
Over the course of only 5 decades, financial planning rose from obscurity to a well-respected discipline through the determined efforts of those who saw the need for a profession dedicated to helping consumers realize their most important goals through the assistance of ethical, expert financial advice.
The underlying, driving, unstoppable force is the work that the individual practitioner does every day with the families that they serve.